Be Inspired is about to begin. This is the 11th day of the Fast of Daniel for complete joy.
A very good evening to all of you. May God bless you abundantly and welcome to one more program, Be Inspired, as we are going through the Fast of Daniel. And we noticed yesterday when we did the program, we noticed that there were, when we invited people to ask questions, there was a pertinent question that kept coming up, asked in different ways. I think we got the same question in like four or five different people asked in different ways, but meaning the same thing. And I believe that what the Holy Spirit will bring to us tonight here in the program will clarify this once and for all. I'd like you to have your Bible open and ready in the book of John, Gospel of John, chapter 1. And we're going to watch a video that gives us a background of what we're going to be talking about today. And in the meantime, again, I would like to open the floor via the chat here of the program. If you have any questions regarding the Fast of Daniel, the Holy Spirit, your deliverance, whatever it is that you would like us to answer here in the question. In fact, today we have more pastors here in the studio than usual. We have myself, Pastor Ade, Pastor Joseph, Pastor David, and Pastor Lucas. We're going to be here, all of us together, meditating on the Word of God. So you can have your Bible ready on John chapter 1. And if you have any question regarding the matters of the faith, you can write them down on the chat now as the video is playing. And when we come back, there will be a time in the program we're going to try to answer them. In the meantime, have your Bible ready in John chapter 1.
More than ever in recent history, there has been a trend in Christian circles to focus on the feeling of God's Spirit. People often refer to a church as being good when they had an emotional experience in the service because of a song or because the environment was welcoming. A service will be described as good if the person had a great feeling during the prayer. But is this what really equips a person to be a true believer? Is it a feeling that prepares a person to face and overcome the tribulations of this world? A church should not be a place that leads people to feel good, but that equips them with the truth that comes from the Word of God. That truth, in many cases, is inconvenient to us because it highlights our mistakes and points out the need to change. If a person truly wants to receive the baptism with the Holy Spirit, they must completely remove from their mind the misconception that he is a feeling or a fleeting emotion. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become sons of God. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. God is so great that he wants to live inside those who are truly thirsty for him. He wants to do great things through those who are his vessels. Let us not reduce him to a feeling that can be reproduced by a scene in a film.
Okay, we're going to talk about this verse you saw there on the video. And actually, I was reading this verse this morning on the New King James Version. But then I went to the King James Version, which a lot of people don't like to use it because it's an older English. But we can say that is a, in some cases, more faithful version to the original text. And look what the Bible says about receiving the Holy Spirit. John chapter 1, Gospel of John chapter 1, verse 12 says, "But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of the blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of men, but of God. There's a few important things here. Number one, if we go to the second part of the verse, verse 13, it says they were not born of the blood, of the will of the flesh, or the will of men. There are people who believe they become born of God because the father was a pastor, because the mother was an assistant. So they say, well, I have someone in my family who was always of God and they brought me up in the church, so surely I am of God. And that's not true, because salvation is individual. It says here, also not of the will of men. What is the will of men? We were saying, Pastor Adi, just before we started the program, that sometimes the person is, they think they were baptized with the Holy Spirit, but they have doubts. And then they come to speak to the pastor, and they say, Pastor, I believe I was received, I believe I received the Holy Spirit, but I'm having some doubts. And sometimes the person is expecting the pastor to encourage them to believe that they did receive the Holy Spirit. And if that happens, the person can believe that they are of God, that they have the Holy Spirit because of the will of the pastor. No, you are. Believe. You are. And actually, I've seen this happening many times. I've seen pastors in their perfectly good intentions trying to help someone to be born, because they want the person to be born of God so much. They try to motivate the person into believing that they are. But then the person will believe that they are because of the will of the pastor. And that's not what it means to be baptized with the Holy Spirit.
Indeed, Bishop. Good evening, everyone. Just as you mentioned now, Bishop, it's very much true. And many times this has happened in the past where people come and their question that they're looking for, you know, answers for may be genuine. But at the same time, they want the pastor or whoever it may be to convince them that they have a relationship with God, that they know God. But it's not true, Bishop. Mm. As you mentioned, salvation is individual. And as the word of God says, it's the Spirit of God that convinces our spirit that we belong to God.
Yeah.
So that's not the job of the pastors. It's exclusively the work of the Holy Spirit.
And something very clear we need to understand is this. When you read this verse here, but as many as received him, to them gave he power. The Holy Spirit is power. So let's talk about how you know that you've received the Holy Spirit. Let's answer that question once and for all. I believe after we speak about this tonight, there can't be any doubt. In fact, Jaden wrote here, hello, Bishop, I believe I received the Holy Spirit, but I spoke to my leader in the youth group, and she told me I needed to sacrifice more as I can't have received the Holy Spirit that easily. What are the stages of receiving the Holy Spirit? Well, let's talk about how you know that you are baptized with the Holy Spirit. The Bible here says, those who receive him, to them God gave power. So when you receive the Holy Spirit, what happens in many instances? People say, Bishop, I received the Holy Spirit because I was in the service and I had this experience and I cried and I really felt God embracing me. But when they leave the church, they remain the same doubtful person they were before. They remain the same confused person they were before, the same scared person they were before, the same unforgiving person they were before. And it's not possible. The two things do not match. You cannot put these two things together. A person who has the Holy Spirit and they're afraid. A person who has the Holy Spirit and is confused about their belief, their faith, or confused about whether they have received the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is what? Is power. Attention, everyone. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit is power. How can you come into contact with power and not know that you've come into contact with power? There's no space for confusion. You know, we have here on the wall, you can't see it, but we have some power outlets here on the wall, some power sockets, right? If you get your fingers wet with water and then you go and you By the way, don't do that. But if you get your fingers wet with water and you put them in the electrical socket and you have this power surge coursing through your body, are you going to tell me that that happened without you noticing? How can you not notice when you get an electric shock? The Holy Spirit is not an electric shock, but it's power. So how do you know that someone received the Holy Spirit? After the experience, the moment of the baptism with the Holy Spirit, that person changes. They stop having hang-ups about their body. I don't know if that's the right word, Pastor David. They stop having hang-ups about their body because whether they're too short, too tall, too this, too that. The person stops being confused. The person stops, you know, thinking, oh, maybe I don't have. No, all that ceases to, it stops existing because it's power. It's power for you to overcome temptation, for you to overcome your past, for you to live in newness of life. So we have to understand this. If a person is in that middle term, because I had this experience in the service and it was so nice and I felt so loved and embraced. But then afterwards, the same person you were continues, that can't be the Holy Spirit. Because he, look at, for example, many who are watching us now, they had the privilege of being here in person in the meeting of Bishop Macedo. Bishop Macedo physically is not a very imposing figure at all. Yet no one can deny that when he opens his mouth, what comes out of his mouth? Power. And this is the Holy Spirit, Pastor David. For example, I imagine that when you mentioned this here before, that before receiving the Holy Spirit, you would go to the bishop asking, Bishop, I don't know what I'm going to do with my future. I don't know what I'm going to study. You were uncertain. You had all these uncertainties about your future. But I imagine that when you received the Holy Spirit, all that changed.
Everything, Bishop. It's so powerful what you're saying, Bishop, because we even think about the example of the disciples. You know, before they received the Holy Spirit, Jesus gave them a certain type of power, right? To cast out demons. They could cast out demons and, you know, perform miracles and heal the sick, but it was only after they received the Holy Spirit that they received true power. And that was power to overcome yourself, power to overcome your internal battles, the, you know, the desires of the flesh, power to overcome your fears, like Peter did, right? Before he was baptized in the Holy Spirit, he denied Jesus three times. But as soon as he received the Holy Spirit, he has power to say, no, I am a follower of the Lord Jesus. I am a disciple of the Lord Jesus. Not even afraid even to die for the Lord Jesus. But that's the type of power that God gives. And that's why a person who truly receives the Holy Spirit, they know, Bishop, because all of a sudden, all the fears, all the, you know, the bad intentions they had of wanting to receive the Holy Spirit, all the things that were inside of them that they couldn't overcome before, they start to overcome.
We have a comment here, and I want to address 2 points. One of them will be with you here, Pastor Ade. Someone said, I'm trying to grasp the understanding of what I need to do before receiving the Holy Spirit, because my leader really confused me, to be honest. First of all, Pastor Ade, I would like, from today, we're going to eradicate this word leader. Okay, from there's no leader. The leader is the Lord Jesus. But, you know, we've been explaining here what needs to be done in order to receive the Holy Spirit. You have to take what comes from the altar. Sometimes going to too many people ends up confusing you. Take what comes from the altar. Take what comes from this program and put that into action in terms of you seeking the Holy Spirit, what needs to be done. This has been explained extensively. We see, Pastor Lucas, that the moment that the Spirit of God comes upon a person, you don't need to be convinced that you have the Spirit of God or that you don't have. So when a person says, when a person receives the Holy Spirit, they don't need validation. They don't need to go to the pastor or the bishop or an assistant to ask, do you think this? Because it's an experience. Number one, it's an experience like no other. And number two, because the experience itself does not necessarily mean that you receive the Holy Spirit, is what comes afterwards. You become this person that you don't know where from. Well, you know where from, but you have this strength that you never had before. You become this person that, whereas before you were so insecure, you didn't know what you wanted to do with your future, what you wanted to, you had all these insecurities about your past, and all this disappears. Bishop, but will we still have those same, if I had an insecurity because I'm short, for example, well, you will still be short after you receive the Holy Spirit, but that makes no difference to you. That has no bearing in your ability to succeed. All your shortcomings only come to make you depend more on the Spirit of God. After all, Pastor Lucas, the Bible says that God shows the small things, the little things, the despised things of this world to confuse the ones who think are something. So the Holy Spirit, He matches up what we don't have.
Exactly, Bishop. I can tell from experience. When I received the Holy Spirit, I was 15 years old. What I hated the most, Bishop, was to speak in public. Mm-hmm. This was my greatest fear. I would skip school because I didn't want to present to the class the work. Mm-hmm. And I received the Holy Spirit, the power, right? Power to overcome the fear. Mm-hmm. And this is what I do every day, mm-hmm. right? As a pastor, we speak in public. And when I was 15 years old, I was raised assistant, and I had to hold a service because I remember the pastor never came back from the radio. I was taking care of the church, and I had to hold the service, the night service. And because I had this experience with God, I was sure I had the Holy Spirit. So I had this voice saying, you can do it. And you know, Bishop, if the person has an experience, and after that experience, they have even more doubts than they had before.
Yes. Then something is wrong.
Something's wrong. Because when God speaks to us, that's it, Bishop. You need no validation. His word is enough. He said it, it's done. It's said it.
Yeah. So what confirms whether a person truly is baptized with the Holy Spirit or not is not the moment of the prayer. Because, listen, people can cry. You know, music is a very powerful thing. There's a reason why, myself, this is, everyone's different, but there's a reason why, for example, Bishop Macedo has said this before, and I prefer to sing the old songs. Because they are less focused on emotion and more focused on the message that is written. Some of the songs, there's a preaching in that message. There's other songs nowadays that they could very easily be any pop song from any pop singer in the world. So you can experience a moment of warmth because of a song, because of a chord progression with the keyboard player who's there, because something like that. And that's why in the Universal Church, we strip down the moment of the service as much as possible. You know, in some church, very few, we have a keyboard player. Very few churches have a keyboard player. And then we have a pastor who usually sings very badly, right? Like myself. But you can feel something in the service because of the moment of the song, the moment of, you know, an emotion you had there. That's not where you will see that you will have the Holy Spirit. If you receive the Holy Spirit, that moment you received an assurance, a power. But it's afterwards that you come to see, let's see now, if the Spirit of God is in me, I'm going to be able to deal with things differently. That's where the assurance comes from. We're going to watch now a testimony of someone who received this power, the power that comes from above that we spoke about. And a little bit later, we'll come back to pray together with you.
I remember one day, me and my daughter's dad had a really bad argument and it escalated. We started fighting. At that point, I kind of realized that I was actually really stuck. my relationship with my family was not good. I wasn't so close to them. My family was very much different. So it was only me and my mum. At home, I used to be rude. I never used to listen. I used to just cause problems all the time. And, you know, I had a lot going on as well, like in terms of school. I would always be with friends who were not very good. It was a mess from the beginning, basically. At some point, I became frustrated because I was coming to the church, but I couldn't really understand. I didn't want to be there, but I had to go there because my mum used to take me. And then I ended up at, I think, about 16. And then when I left, things, of course, got worse. I remember I was really skinny. I was really like not well. I was ill, you know. I used to suffer with like really bad migraines. I remember one day me and my daughter's dad had a really bad argument and it escalated. We started fighting. At that point, I kind of realized that I was actually really stuck. And then finally that relationship broke down. I was left alone to care for my daughter, so it was really hard for me. I got to the point where I said, okay, enough is enough. A friend invited me and I went back to the church, and then I started to see some improvements, but I didn't give myself fully. I still was 1 foot in, 1 foot out. So again, I was left frustrated. So when I left the church again, it came to a point where I started to lose a lot. So after I had my daughter, I had some miscarriages, which was really traumatic. After that, my dad passed away, you know, and I just thought, I'm always losing. I just can't seem to be happy, no matter what I do. Then I had to deal with other areas of my life, you know, my family. I didn't have a job because of my migraines. I couldn't keep a job because I was always sick. And then I had, obviously, the internal issues as well. I would cry, I would get angry, I would get frustrated, I would take out my anger on even my daughter, anyone, whoever was around me. I'm afraid of my future. One day I decided to go back to a service that they were having on Friday. And when I was in the service, I just felt different. My mind felt actually clear. I actually realized I shouldn't be struggling with constant doubts, fears. And I actually decided, do you know what, I'm actually going to give my all. And I started the 21-day fast of Daniel. So during that time, God asked me for some things. God would still say, you know, give me your fears, give me your doubts, give me, you know, give me everything that was bothering me inside. I had some grudges, so I had to let go of that. All the bad relationships I left, I gave, like, all the past trauma, I had to forgive myself. Everything. I gave my future, I gave all the doubts, the fears. So the day I received the Holy Spirit was on a Wednesday. I had given everything already during the 21 days. That's when I could feel that sense of peace, joy, happiness. And God told me, God confirmed with me that everything that I'd been through, it's over, like it's done, you know. From then on, things changed. The transformation was so great. I stopped having those terrible doubts. I started to use my faith. I started to believe in myself. Every Saturday, I'm there evangelizing or helping out with the food bank. I am also helping out with CBC, which is such a blessing for me. You know, everything that I've been through has allowed me to become that stronger person. Yes, the Selena today is not like the Selena before. My name's Selena Davidayo, and I received the Holy Spirit during the fast of Daniel.
You see that Selena looks like a completely different person from her photographs that you saw there before. If I didn't know that was the same person, I would have not have recognized her. And Pastor Adi was just reminding me of this verse here that the Lord Jesus said to the disciples before they received the Holy Spirit, where he said, but you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you. and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And this is so true that, that the Holy Spirit is power. This is so true that the one who denied the Lord Jesus three times and refused to accept or to recognize that he was a disciple of the Lord Jesus for fear of dying, that one later, he preached in a way where many people were converted. He was arrested and beaten. And then when he was being released, he said, look, don't speak about Jesus again. Otherwise, you will be arrested again. And he said, look, how can I not speak about Jesus? How can I not speak about him? So you see that he received power to do what he didn't have the courage to do before. Pastor Joseph, before he didn't have the courage to stand up for his faith after receiving the Holy Spirit, he had no problem with that. We see sometimes we have people who go to evangelize with us and they don't speak very good English, right? The pastors are an example of this. We have pastors, people, let's be honest. We have pastors in our church who speak, you have English, then you have broken English, and then you have crippled English. But we have pastors who are on that level there of, you know, very poor English. But they preach very confidently to people, to doctors. We have doctors who sit in the congregation, people with degrees, lawyers, and the pastors are there. I remember a pastor I think Stamford Hill, and he was saying, he was preaching, some people from Stamford Hill might remember this, he was preaching and saying to the person that he was going to pray because she said, oh, Pastor, I have pains in my stomach. I said, okay, I'm going to pray for God to heal your womb. And she said, no, Pastor, not my womb, my stomach. And he said, no, I know it's your womb. You are trying to trick me. He thought she was trying to. That's the level. But he prayed for her with faith. We have pastors who, this is the power, this is the boldness that the Holy Spirit gives us. That when we speak, even though we don't have the conditions to represent the Lord Jesus to the level that he deserves, but we don't let that stop us because the Holy Spirit steps in. We see a person manifested with demons on the altar. When a person is full of the Holy Spirit, they are empowered by the Holy Spirit. He speaks through them. Actually, the Lord Jesus said this. Do not be afraid. Do not be worried when you are taken, when you are arrested and taken to the authorities, because I will speak through you. I will tell you what to speak. So the Holy Spirit gives us this power.
Peter even said to Jesus, I'm ready to go to the prison. But he said out of his flesh, because he didn't have the Spirit of God. He didn't know himself when he said that. But after he received the Holy Spirit, he was that bold man, as you are saying, and he would go to a city. He would, you know, do wonderful work because of the Holy Spirit. You know, when you have the Spirit inside of you, you can keep your mouth closed because you start visualizing, see souls. You don't see a drunkard, you see a soul. You don't see someone like, let's say you see someone fight on the street, a couple fight. You try to go there because you see, you know, two souls that are suffering. Your vision of souls are different. You don't want to fight people on the street because you start seeing souls. There was a day, Bishop, I was going to Hammersmith and a woman was driving, passed by me. And I don't know why she stopped the car and started shouting. In that moment, I told my wife, for sure, I'm not the reason why she's fighting. The reason why she screamed at me probably came from her house or her husband who said something to her. And let her shout, because for sure, I'm just passed by her. But when you have this vision, we stop these filthy fights. It has no sense because you start to see souls and the willingness is to help others.
Yeah. I believe that tonight the Holy Spirit revealed to you that there is no need for us to be asking, how do I know I received the Holy Spirit? Was it really the Holy Spirit? What if but someone told me that maybe it's not the Holy Spirit? If you are in this level of questions, it's because it wasn't the baptism with the Holy Spirit. Because when it is, you're sure. You're certain. Because you have this power inside of you that nothing can stop you, that nothing can hold you back. And not only you have that experience of the power of God entering your life, like Jesus said, but you shall receive power, but also you have that power with you from that moment on. So the situations where before you were afraid to talk to your boss, to talk to an authority, to talk to the person you like. Tonight we had the singles hour in the love therapy. A person who is full of the Holy Spirit, they are bold. They are bold. If I'm sorry, but you know, sometimes we see men who say they have the Holy Spirit and they're afraid to go and talk to the woman, to say to the woman that you like her. If the Spirit of God is in you, my dear friend, you're not afraid of rejection or failure, because with the Spirit of God, you don't fail. With the Spirit of God, you don't fail. You learn, or that didn't work, but the next one is going to work. Okay, let's go and pray. Janet wrote here, it's not even about the lack of English. As long as somebody's full of the Holy Spirit, anything is possible. That's it, Janet. That's the Spirit. Amen. Let's prepare ourselves to pray. Let's talk to God. My Lord, tonight we ended that perception of feeling God, which is the biggest lie of the devil. The biggest con of the devil is to make people think they need to feel God. In fact, your word never ever says feel God, ever. And many have been jumping from church to church, looking for a church that makes them feel great because of a band, a choir, a pastor who's charismatic, who's funny. And in wanting to feel something, they forget that you are not a feeling, my God. You are power. You are power. Power to transform, to change our mentality. Power that allows everyone to receive the strength that they need. When they have your Spirit, they have the strength that they need to overcome temptation permanently. No one full of the Holy Spirit is falling into sin on and off. It's not possible, because you gave us power, my Lord, to be consistent in our faith, to be, my Lord, filled with this faith, my Father, that nothing can hold us back when your Spirit is in us, the Spirit of creation. How can I be defeated when the Spirit of creation is in me? How can I live under fear? How can I be afraid of doing great exploits for the Lord when the Spirit of God is in me? And it's not down to my capacity. It's not down to my capacity. It's not down to my education. It's not down to my level of intelligence. It's down to the power that you have given me, my Lord. When you live inside of me, everything is possible. My friend, tell God, Lord, I want your power. You said in your word that you would give us power when your spirit comes upon us. I'm asking you here now for this power. I'm not asking you, Lord, to have a feeling of something moving within me or of a warmth. I'm asking for power because in the moment of torment, of problems, a warmth will not make me overcome those problems. A feeling will not make me overcome those problems. But in the moment of trouble and temptation, when my faith is tested, like Peter was after receiving your spirit, he never backed down. And with you, Father, I will never back down. I know that if your spirit is in me, I will never back down. So there where you are, friend, receive the power of God. Take hold of this promise. Like any promise he made before for you, the promise of the blessing in your family, the promise of a better future. There is no greater promise than that of the Holy Spirit. Tell him that you want him. Receive him right now where you are. The presence of God comes upon you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. My Lord, thank you for the inspiration that you gave us now in the moment of this prayer that I will share with these people right now before the end of the serve of this program. I bless these people in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Look, as we were praying here, I even cut the prayer short because the Holy Spirit gave us an inspiration. Tomorrow we are going to do something very special. After the evening service, we're going to do the evening service tomorrow. We start the chain of prayer of the path, the holy path of salt. The salt there from Israel. We'll tell you more about it tomorrow in the service. And we have the second week of the chain of prayer that we began last Friday. But after the evening service, we're going to end the service. We're going to wait for people to leave, those who are not interested in the Holy Spirit. And we're going to stay behind with those who want the Holy Spirit to have a mini night vigil of the Holy Spirit. This is in every church. Every church, your pastor there, after the evening service, he'll counsel the people, wait for everyone to go. And then afterwards, we will be seeking the baptism with the Holy Spirit there for you to receive this power. We'll be laying hands on you. We'll be there for you who've been surrendering yourself for you to receive this power. Amen. May God bless you. We'll see you tomorrow in the church and here tonight and here in the evening in the program as well. God bless you.
This alabaster jar, it's all I have of worth. I break it at your feet, Lord. It's less than you deserve. You're far more beautiful, more precious than the oil, the sum of my desires and the fullness of my joy. Like you spilled your blood, I spill my heart as an offering to my King. Here I am, take me as an offering. Here I am, giving every heartbeat for your time that I have left is all I have of worth. I lay it at your feet, Lord. It's less than you deserve. And though I've little strength, and though my days are few, You gave your life for me, so I will live my life for you. Like you spill your blood, I spill my heart as an offering to my King. Here I am, take me as an offering. Here I am, giving every heartbeat for your glory. Take me. Take me. Every